A colossus of Irish literary life walked free from Reading jail, having served 2 years of penal servitude for what was then deemed a crime, indecent conduct or homosexual practices, and I refer, of course, to the one and only Oscar Wilde. Ulick, Wilde is admired in Ireland and indeed the UK as a poet, playwright and writer of immense stature. But in your view, how does he rate on the world's literary stage?
I'd say after Shakespeare. He's regarded as the best mannered playwright. That's mannered comedy, you know, The Importance of Being Earnest, The Ideal Husband, in the world, yeah. Really. And certainly in the English language, since the Jacobeans and the people of the 17th and 18th century, Sheridan and Goldsmith and others. But apart from that, he wrote so many different things. There's this beautiful poetry. He also wrote Dorian Gray, of course, an amazing novel as it is. And he was, without doubt, the greatest conversationalist the English language has ever known. He was a sort of sophisticated Chanakey, somebody who had the Irish storytelling gift, the Irish wit, and at the same time, he could go to London in English, he could go to Paris in French, and he could have them round him listening like the Irish people would have listened to a Chanakey.
Well, whatever with the French in Paris, penetrating the upper classes of English society, upper middle classes of English society, would be difficult at the best of times.
And also, at that time, they controlled one third of the globe. They bestrode Europe and they listened to no one. They were arrogant. And especially for an Irishman with his background, because his mother was, of course, a very famous Irish figure, Speranza, Lady Wilde. Yeah. She was a young woman, had been in court with Gavan Duffy. She wrote the document for which Gavan Duffy was deported, the anti-English document, and spent a lot of her life collecting stories and poetry from the Irish people in Irish. She was known as Speranza.
Yeah, yeah. Coming back to your own work, you had a play which you wrote some time ago, but it was recently revived, called Trinity of Two. Just for the listeners, explain what you actually tackled in that play.
Well, Wilde, when he was prosecuted in England, and in the circumstance that he was prosecuted, the barrister opposite him was Edward Carson, who had been at Trinity with him, and that's why it was called A Trinity of Two. And of course, Wilde, he beat Carson into the ground every day. You know, Carson used to say, this is a letter you wrote to Lord Alfred Douglas, your slim, gilt soul walks between passion and beauty. Do you think that's beautiful, Mr. Wilde? Not the way you say it, Mr. Carson. You say it very badly indeed, you know, and all that sort of thing. And then finally, Carson got so angry with him, he said, what religion are you? I don't think I have any. I'm an Irish Protestant. So, I mean, he knocked him for six. And then on the last day, Carson came in and said, did you kiss this boy? Oh, no, he was peculiarly ugly. Is that the reason you didn't kiss him? Is that the reason you... And Wilde fell apart. And the jury came in with a verdict of guilty. But of course, it was ridiculous when you think there were... What he was convicted for then was sex between men, which is legal today.
Well, of course,
And of course, it was rife in England. It was called the vis anglais, you know. No one can ever understand why Wilde didn't take the chance, because they really didn't want to prosecute him, because in the long run, it meant that they'd have had to prosecute half the upper classes.
It was also known as the third game in public schools,
yes,
after rugby and cricket.
Yes, yes, exactly. And it was poor Oscar getting it.
Yeah, yeah.
They had a boat ready for him with drink and everything on him to take him out. The establishment tried to get rid of him. And his mother said to him, Lady Wilde Speranza, who was living in London, she said, Oscar, you're an Irish gentleman and you do not run away. If you stay and face the trial, you will be my son for life. Otherwise, I will never speak to you again. And he said, Mama, 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 but he stayed. And I think that really was the Irish and English attitude towards things.
It could have been avoided. All he had to do was leave London.
Yeah.
Or get out of England, sorry.
That's right.
Yeah. So he could have gone to France or he could have come back here.
And they had a boat ready for him.
Yeah,
the establishment had a boat with Frank Harris on it and wine and everything to take off. And he just sat there and waited for the arrest to come along.
And some would call that foolish bravery.
Well, the mother thought it could say being an Irish gentleman as being a foolish bravery, you know.
Yeah,
but she felt that way, you see, because she was prosecuted, as I said, as a rebel in 1848, and she was a legend among the Irish people.
Which actually is something that he did not inherit that much, because he was never renowned as being a Republican of any great sort. I mean, obviously the sympathies were there because it comes out in a lot of the plays and writings. Yeah.
But he actually said it. He said, we Irish are a race of brilliant failures. He said, we're the greatest talkers since the Greeks. And he did say continually, I am an Irishman, not an Englishman. And he was an Irish patriot in every way, in the sense that he didn't let Ireland vanish off his personality, and he used his Irish background as a means of attaining the greatness that he did.
Being an Irishman in that situation would almost have been, you know, like a performing fool in the eyes of a lot of English people, would it not?
No, because really...
Like the court jesters, what I
mean. Well, yes, but you see, it was more than that. Here are these great salons of the aristocracy. They listened to him. The French said that instead of words, he used pearls they used to drop from his lips. He had this magic gift. It was the Shanachie, old Irish thing, but it was sophisticated to a degree that people were literally hypnotised. And I think that's one of the reasons the English brought him down. They couldn't stand that an Irishman would come and have this extraordinary position in England and Ireland as a talker.
Yeah, well, as a talker, I'd like to ask you this. You know, his accent, which honestly, I don't know. I've seen the film by Stephen Fry, in which Stephen Fry basically plays him as an Englishman, in terms of voice now only, I mean.
Well, I think that's a very good observation, actually, because I'd made a film with Stephen Fry on Oscar Wilde, a documentary.
This is before his feature film.
I quite agree with you. See, Wilde would have had, basically, the Irish pitch. He wouldn't have had that upper-class English pitch.
Yeah.
And he had mastered the Oxford accent. But remember, he was at Trinity for 3 or 4 years. And Trinity fellas have that Dublin Protestant drawl, which he would have had. I call it the Protestant drawl, where they sort of almost have Dublin accents. But he would have refined that. But there's only one recording of him, and I've heard that. And he definitely had what I call the low Irish pitch. And he would have, because of the Oxford background, naturally.
Yeah, so it wouldn't have been pronounced as, say, Yeats, or even Gogarty.
No, Yeats had a sort of rich Irish voice.
That's
like
right,
that,
but
nevertheless was slightly upper class.
Yeah.
But Oscar wouldn't, but he would not have had an English pitch to his voice, and he made it clear that he was Irish and not English, especially in France, of course.
You mentioned there the whole thing of the comedy of manners and all the rest of it, and you're talking about essentially drawing room humour. If one has to embrace these things in parentheses, how relevant is it today? I mean, as you've said, you know, it's still produced throughout the world, but what is its relevance for us?
Well, it's just wonderful, witty theatre that has never been equaled. But don't forget, Oscar was a great poet. And here's a sonnet that he wrote called Hélas, short but beautiful. And this is the work of a genius and a great Irish poet. To drift with every passion till my soul is a stringed lute on which all winds may play. Is it for this that I have given away mine ancient wisdom under austere control? Sometimes methinks my life is a twice-written scroll scrawled over on some boyish holiday with idle songs for pipe and varlet that do but mar the secret of the whole. Surely there was a time I might have trod the sunlit heights and from life's dissonance struck one clear chord to reach the ears of God. Is that time dead? Lo, with a little rod I did but touch the honey of romance, and must I lose my soul's inheritance?